Spirit. Amen. A few weeks ago, one of the news networks did a profile on a surfer dude. And this surfer dude inhabits the beaches of Southern California. He surfs every day, and he has no interest in a job. In fact, he even wrote a song about how terrible and uncool it is to hold down a steady job. It's not that he can't get a job. He's not really a victim of the high unemployment rate. He just has no interest in a job. It doesn't fit his plans or his lifestyle. He lives with friends here and there, and he gets some food assistance from the government. The cameras followed the surfer dude to the grocery store, where he picked up some supplies for a party with his fellow surfer dudes. Picked up some steaks and some lobsters, which he paid for with his assistance card. And when the reporter asked him what he would say to the taxpayers who funded those steaks and lobsters, he very sincerely said, "Thank you, taxpayers! Thank you!" And as a taxpayer, I guess I would politely say, "You're welcome." But I would also want to tell this young surfer dude that there is a God-given beauty and a God-given dignity to the concept of work. Our society does not always appreciate work. Look at the images of the workplace in our popular culture, for instance. Go back to 9 to 5, both the Dolly Parton song and the movie it inspired. Working 9 to 5, what a way to make a living. Barely getting by, it's all taking and no giving. And think, too, about Glengarry Glen Ross, the play and the movie. Guys in a real estate office politicking against each other, stabbing each other in the back. And then I've been working my way through the recently released DVD set of Dobie Gillis, a show from my childhood. And in that show, there's this cute little theme that whenever the word work is mentioned in conversation, Bob Denver's beatnik character shrieks, "Work!" in absolute terror. And some popular songs indicate that work is just a painful necessity that you have to endure in order to get some free time. Everyone is working for the weekend. Remember that song? And John Lennon informs us, a man must break his back to earn his day of leisure. And Springsteen tells us, Monday when the foreman calls time, I've already got Friday on my mind. Work is a necessary evil, according to these songs. I remember, too, when Johnny Paycheck came out with that beloved song, Take This Job and Keep It. I cleaned that up. When that song came out, it hit a major nerve. People all over America cheered that song. I certainly did because I was stuck in a job I didn't like, and no, I was not a pastor at the time, all right? So work does not get a lot of respect. And yet, there are other songs, like Merle Haggard, Working Man's Blues. I'll keep on working, long as my two hands are fit to use. Or all the songs about driving a truck. As the son of a truck driver, I appreciate those songs and how they hold up that calling, that job, in a very powerful way. And there is a great Cajun country song called Roughneck's Paradise, which I heard on the radio in Louisiana and finally located on iTunes, where the singer actually envisions heaven as an oil drilling platform. It's a land of diamond-studded drill bits, and Kelly's made of gold. The driller makes all connections, and he's never out of the hole. Man, you really have to like your job if you dream about doing it in heaven, that's all I can say. So there is music out there that celebrates the dignity of work. And think of some of the reality shows of recent years, like The Deadliest Catch, or Ice Road Truckers, or even Gator Boys, or Duck Dynasty. What do these shows depict? A lot of times they depict people doing their work. And maybe their work their daily work. So they uphold the God-given dignity and the God-given beauty of work. Now, when I talk about the God-given beauty and dignity of work, I'm not just talking about work that's done for a salary either. After all, some people are retired. Some people have trouble getting a paying job. Some people do their work in the home. And all of this unsalaried work also has beauty and dignity. Things like washing clothes, fixing meals, changing diapers, cutting grass, helping out in the community, taking out the garbage. I often hear retired people say, "I'm busier now than I was when I was working." So you don't have to be pulling down a salary to experience the God-given beauty and the God-given dignity of work. There is beauty and dignity in the uncompensated work that people do in our community and in their homes. And all work is done for God. The Bible says, "Whatever you do, work heartily, as for the Lord and not for man." Work heartily as for the Lord and not for man. So it doesn't matter who signs your paycheck. Doesn't matter whether you're working in the kitchen or in the garden or on Wall Street. Whatever you do, you are working for God. And that means we always want to do our best. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might, Scripture says. Because we're working for God, we want to give it our very best. It's interesting to look at the parables of Jesus, because a lot of our Savior's parables are based on people's daily labor. A sower goes out to sow seeds. And for Jesus, this farm labor becomes an image of the Word of God being proclaimed to the world. A woman puts some yeast in dough as she's getting ready to make bread. And for Jesus, that act becomes an image of the kingdom of God spreading through the world. A woman sweeps her house and finds a lost coin, and that becomes an image of how Jesus came into the world to seek us lost sinners. A shepherd loses a sheep and goes out to find it. Again, an image of Jesus bringing us lost sinners back to God. A fisherman brings in a catch in his nets, and he separates the good fish from the bad fish, and that represents for Jesus the final judgment. A merchant finds a beautiful pearl and invests everything he has to get that pearl. A reminder of how the kingdom of God is supremely worthy above all other things. And all these parables of Jesus are drawn from people's everyday work. And Jesus finds in that daily work a sacred meaning. Now, sometimes we think that church work is a higher calling than other work. And indeed, Jesus did call his disciples away from their regular occupations. St. Peter and John and James left their fishing nets. St. Matthew left his tax collecting booth. And yet, that was not a universal prescription. St. Paul was proud to continue his work as a tent maker, even as he proclaimed the word of God and preached the gospel. And there's something John the Baptist said that is worth pondering. Today, by the way, is actually the feast of the martyrdom of John the Baptist. So I kind of wanted to get John the Baptist in here, because there is a saying in Luke's gospel where people come to be baptized. And some of the people who came to be baptized were tax collectors. And some of the people who came to be baptized were soldiers. Now, you might expect John the Baptist to say to the tax collectors, "Stop collecting taxes and follow the Lord." And you might expect John the Baptist to say to the soldiers, leave the army and follow the Lord. But on the contrary, John the Baptist says to the tax collectors, collect no more than you are authorized to do. And to the soldiers he says, do not extort money from anyone by threats or false accusations, but be content with your wages. In other words, St. John the Baptist says to these folks, keep on doing your job and do it in a conscientious and responsible way. He doesn't say, leave your job and follow Jesus. But rather he says, do your job in a godly fashion. I never think my job is better than anybody else's, just because I'm a pastor. Sometimes people say to me, You don't have a job, you have a calling.
But really, every job is a calling.
Being a truck driver like my father was, that's a calling. Being a mom or a dad is a calling. Being a short order cook is a calling. Being a stockbroker is a calling. Being a salesman is a calling. Being a teacher is a calling. These are all godly tasks. Because all honest work is done for God. You know, there's a grocery tycoon from my hometown. Howard Butt is his name. He runs a chain of grocery stores, the HEB chain. He's a Christian, and he has this wonderful radio spot called The High Calling of Our Daily Work. And those radio spots that he has are about ordinary people working jobs who excel and innovate in their jobs, who give it their best. The High Calling of Our Daily Work. All work is a God-given calling. My job is no better than yours. I work for God. Yes, but so do you. Whatever work you do in your life, you're doing it for God. I think it's been a while since I mentioned Bill Wamsgans in a sermon. Bill Wamsgans achieved immortality back in 1920. And what did he do to achieve immortality? Anybody remember? Well, you probably don't remember, but anybody know? Anybody know what Bill Wamsgans did back in 1920? As the second baseman for the Cleveland Indians, he executed the only unassisted World Series triple play. Only unassisted World Series triple play. Now, the Indians had made baseball history in a tragic way that year. In August of 1920, shortstop Ray Chapman became the only person ever killed by a pitched ball in the history of baseball. So Wamsgans' historic triple play was kind of a nice memorial to his fallen teammate. And how did he do it? Well, basically he caught the ball in the air. He caught it, a drive in the air for one out. Then he stepped on it second base to double off the runner. It was off second base. And then he tagged a runner coming in from first. Runner coming in from first may have been a little confused at what was happening, so Wamsgans may have had some luck with the play. But it was a great play, a great moment in baseball. And Bill Wamsgans was the son of a Lutheran Church of Missouri Synod pastor. And Bill originally planned to follow in his father's footsteps. So he enrolled at Concordia Seminary in St. Louis to begin training to be a pastor. But the Cleveland Indians had recognized Bill's talent, and they offered him a contract. So he had an agonizing decision to make. The ministry or baseball. And Bill went to his father, the pastor, and told his father his quandary. And his father said something like, "Son, God has given you a great talent. Playing baseball is good, honest work. It's something you can do to the glory of God. So if you want to take your talent and go into baseball, God is not going to be displeased. You're still going to be working for God." And Pastor Wamsgans was right. And when Bill executed that unassisted triple play, he was glorifying God. Just as all good, honest work glorifies God. God works. God works all the time. He did take a day off once, right after the creation. But God works continually. He leads the galaxies in their cosmic dance. He makes the planets spin around the sun, and the electrons and protons spin around the nucleus in each atom. But as the popular Christian song says, his most awesome work was done in the frailty of his son, Jesus. Now, Jesus worked as a carpenter, indeed. But his truest work was to die for our sins. That was the job he had when he came into the world. And he was tempted to walk away from that job. Just like we are all tempted to walk away from our jobs from time to time. In Gethsemane, he said, "Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me." So he was tempted to walk away from his job. But in the end, he did the job that he came to do. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. And his hands found incredible work to do. the salvation of the world. And for the salvation of the world, those carpenter's hands that are also the hands of God, those hands were nailed to the wood of the Holy Cross. And so his work was accomplished. And now we do our work, whether in an office or a job site or at home, and we do it to the glory of the one whose work is our salvation, our forgiveness, our peace. Praise and glory to him now and always. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ to life everlasting. Amen.